thank you for being here and for waiting. And my name is Jeremy. If you did not know, and this is a Q&A, you can answer me ask me questions, and I will answer them. I guess we'll just launch into it, unless you guys want a brief bio, backstory, some of the roles I've done, or we can just do questions. Okay, question. Yes.
Hi, I loved your work on the GSA games.
Oh, thank you.
How did you get involved in that project, and anything that you know about the board game would be really helpful that you're probably not allowed to talk about it.
No. Honestly, if you guys probably know things far more than earlier than we know about them, which is hilarious because I don't know that I could talk about something. I actually don't even know if I'm working on something until someone sends me a message on Twitter. So I don't know anything about
Last I heard, she sent out a New Year's message saying, don't worry guys, I promise, after this big project that the company's, they're a pretty small company, is doing, she said, next priority is GSA number 4, and they left us with such a cliffhanger, but you were adorable.
Thank you.
Lean A plus funny equals love.
Yeah, I mean, the way I got involved in that is, it's Afia Yu's company, who is a voice actor, and her partner in crime is Michael Solazad. And so I'm friends with both of them, and they just said, like, do you want to come by our apartment and record stuff into a box setup that we have? And I was like, yeah, okay. And then she, like, games kept coming, so that was, like, really cool. And I love that character. So that was how that happened. It was, like, friends working together, which is cool. Yes?
Would you ever want to work with the big names in the voice actor tree, like Rob Halston, Tara Strong, or Kevin Michael Richardson, along with voice character named Andre Romano?
Yeah, I mean, any opportunity to work on anything, I'm super excited because all I want to do is work on a character and play a different type of person than what I am. So I don't really care who I'm working with, but yeah, if I'm in a room with people that I've seen their work before or grown up watching them, it's like a starstruck moment of we're in the same room and we're working on this together. This is really surreal and really amazing. I would love to work with them. I would probably need like 5 seconds to breathe before I was able to like say my line and talk to them because that would be weird. But I would be very excited to do it. That would be awesome. Yes.
First of all, congratulations on Sailor Venus.
Thank you. Thank you so much. That was like the best wedding present ever. So cool.
So I noticed that you also played a part in acting for Bones.
Yes.
I was surprised by that, and that made me wonder, which of the two would you prefer, regular acting or voice acting?
I did voice acting forever, and I was like taking, just working nonstop on in front of the mic, and I hadn't done any on camera acting. So then I was like, man, I'm really craving to work on a film or a TV show, and I'll audition for stuff, and sometimes I won't get cast, and I got cast in a movie, and I was gone for voice acting for a whole month. And the whole time I was like working on the film, I'm like, man, today would be a really fun day to go do voice acting. I really miss it. And then once I'm doing voice acting for like 2-3 months, I'm like, man, I really miss on camera. So I think they both work different muscles for me, and if I'm not working on one, I miss it, which is great because that means when I am working on it, I really appreciate every day that I have because I'm like, well, I might not work on this for another 2-3 months. And if I get to work on an on-camera project, those are usually fewer and far between at this point. It's usually like one day maybe, whereas with a voiceover project, if it's a series, I'll get to come back over months and months usually. When I worked on Not Cool with Shane Dawson, I was in Pittsburgh for a month working on that every day, and that was really, really a good time. So, I don't know, I think I would have to do both. I would miss one without the other. Yes.
All right. Like, what was your? My voice is a little too loud.
No, you go first, and then I'll answer yours. So right. Yes, go for it.
Okay. Yeah. Like, what was your favorite? The episode when you were voicing Ashana in the seasons 2 and 3 double Chakriana Ashana.
My favorite episode? That is way too hard. I will say, like, I loved getting to work on the movie because that kind of summed up season one and it got the ball rolling for season two and three. I loved season three because I feel like that kind of got some of the characteristics that we've seen in the movie / season one, plus some of season two, and then everything got really real in season three. And it was really a chance to get super emotional and work with Josh. And Josh and I were really got sucked into that project. We loved that so much. So it was really nice to kind of get really honest and brutal and have things get really serious.
Yeah, well, like, I would have loved to see Carly Mossy, the voice of, like, Delamia, as well as, like, Kent Williams and Bruce Carey, the voices of Alistair and the
I love them. And I've known Bruce Carey probably doesn't even want to know how long he's known me. And Kent Williams I worked with when I was 8 on a little video series called Prayer Bear. Mm-hmm. And so when I was back working with Kent again, that was really, really a fun deal. Because I was like, he was one of the first people that I'd ever worked with. And then now we're working together on voiceover. So it's really, really, really fun.
Yeah.
Yes.
Hi, I'm Kelvin.
Hi.
I just got part 2 of Sailor Moon. And I really love how much gusto you put into your part as Venus.
Thank you. It's probably me just being super excited to be Sailor Venus. I probably should scale that back, but I'm glad you're enjoying it.
I noticed that Minako gets a lot more interesting and weird when Kunihiko Ikuhara takes over as director. And I was wondering if there was any particular scene or episode you're looking forward to dubbing, because I'm thinking of one in particular.
Which one are you thinking of?
I'm thinking of the episode where Minako tries to get her heart stolen.
That'll be awesome to work on. I don't know. I mean, I obviously working in Fairy Tale, I love moments where I get to be really wacky. But I also love really genuine moments. So it'll be really nice. I feel like Sailor V, at least of what I've recorded so far in the series, she's had a lot of really sweet, a lot of really nice, genuine moments. And so I'm very excited to kind of get some of her wacky, girly, like, high school girly side out there a little bit. But I still feel like out of all of the girls, she's kind of not the most composed one. She still likes to have fun, but she's done this before. She's like the kind of the older sister of all the girls. So but yeah, I want to see her kind of let loose a little bit. So that would be exciting to get to work on. Yes.
You said about Fairy Tale being waxy and stuff.
Yeah.
I'm trying to boil it down. I mean, I know Fraser questions are hard, but, like, do you have any favorite, like, wacky moments or episodes that you can remember that like, stand out?
In Fairy Tale, anytime she has, like, a random outburst followed, like, the crazy emotional sides where she has, like, 6 emotions in T-minus 10 seconds, where I'll just be like, how does one person make these kinds of noises, reactions, and screaming this fast? But I love that because it's a challenge, and I kind of don't even think about what anybody thinks about me because I know I'm making some really weird faces behind the glass.
I love the like the one.
Oh yeah.
Like the one she's looking, she thinks not she's in love with her, and the one when she's invisible is also hilarious.
Yes, I love the invisible one.
Which, no flaps.
And yes, and when they said, yeah, so Lucy's invisible in this episode, I was like, so we have no flaps? And they're like, well, for part of it. I was like, what? She's invisible and yet we still have to worry about flaps? Seriously? My other one that I, not for that show, but speaking of like weird flaps, they had cleaned up the animation, so we got a new set of animation on a show, and on this one set, they had done coffee cup flaps, and so we had to like zoom in, so I could watch the reflection of my character in a coffee cup, and I thought like, you really worked to make this difficult for me, but it was a fun challenge.
Thank you.
Yes.
Sort of related. What have been some of your more challenging roles, and how did you overcome whatever challenges those roles presented?
I worked on D. Gray Man. I played Rode in D. Gray Man, and Todd was directing that. And so Todd had cast me in that role, and I remember on the first day, he was like, she's kind of like a playfully, kind of seductive sort of character. And I was like, oh, I'm sorry. That is a word that Jeremy does not like to associate with herself or anything that she does, so thanks. And he was like, no, no, it's going to be fine. I was like, it's actually not going to be fine. And I think this is the only time that I have ever told a director, like, I'm not comfortable doing this. Like, I'll say, like, in a joking way, like, this is really uncomfortable. But I told Todd, I was like, it's you, Sabbat, Vale, all in a room with a camera on me. And, like this is just not comfortable. I've been a voice actor for all of, like, maybe a year. You're just going to stare at me and, like, laugh at me? This is so uncomfortable. I'm everybody's little sister. Like, don't do this to me. And they're like, it's going to be fine, Jeremy. I was like, it's not going to be fine. So we did the first scene. They were like, no, that worked. And I was like, okay. I just, like, and as soon as my first session was over, I, like, did not look anybody in the eye and, like, signed my paper. And then I went home and I was like, this is what being an actor is. You have to put yourself out there. You have to expand your comfort zone. And as long as I'm not feeling threatened or that my morals are being compromised or that someone's attacking me or I don't feel safe, I have no reason to not step out of my box and try something new, because then I'm not learning and I'm not being a better actor, so I need to suck it up. I'm in a very safe environment. Todd and Eric and Chris Sabat are not going to let anything happen to me. They're very protective. And I was like, if we're going to be doing this character with anybody, it's going to be with them. And that's how I feel with everybody at Funimation. They've said, I want you to try this kind of character. And I'm like, I don't know about that. Knee socks and panty and stocking. She's like, it's going to be the deepest voice that you've ever worked on. And Colleen's like, it's actually going to be deeper than my voice in the show. And she directed that show. And I thought, Colleen, you're the queen of, like, deep voices. And you're, no. She's like, it's okay. I'm going to walk you through it. And so each time they've kind of given me a challenge, and this has probably happened in more shows than I can count. They've given me a challenge, and I just had to trust the director. I'm like, if they're willing to take a chance on me and put the work in, then I would be disrespecting their trust in me by not going through with the challenge, and it's only making me better. Jamie Markey was the first director that worked with me on Fight Reactions, and I was like, I am a girl, I was a girly girl, and I am not comfortable making fight reactions in a box like a panda at the zoo while you guys stare at me. I just am not. She was like, it's okay. I was not comfortable either, and we're going to get through it. So each time there's been something that's happened, and I'm like, you know what? Suck it up, Jeremy. Have fun. Live in the moment. They're going to get through it. It's a safe space. And that's what's so great about this industry and working in voice acting, is all of these people really care about each other, and it's a safe space to try stuff new. So, yes?
I actually have more questions.
Okay.
This one is, do Lucy and Natsu a fairy tale ever end up together?
I don't know. I, as a fan of the show, hope that they do, because I, as a fan of the show, am a Nalu shipper. As the voice of Lucy and as Lucy's representative in this room, say that is not going to happen anytime soon. I don't know what is going to happen later on the show, but I was having a discussion with someone. If you'll talk to Todd, he has a completely different opinion, and he's like, it's going to be, Jeremy, it's going to work out. It's going to be fine. I'm like, Todd, look at where the characters are right now. They are not in a place where this would be, this is not the time and place in the show. So I hope that happens. But I certainly don't think Lucy's ready for a relationship.
Certainly
Lucy needs to focus on Lucy. And Natsu needs to focus on Natsu.
My second question is, why is Patty so obsessed with giraffes?
I don't know, but it's been very weird that since I worked on that, it's like giraffes have followed me. I've oddly enough had weird, like, people just started giving me giraffes that don't even watch anime. They just, I've always loved monkeys, and so suddenly people were like, hey, I saw this giraffe and I thought of you. And I was like, that doesn't make any sense unless it's ironic, because I'm a very short person. So why you went like, giraffe, sure, got it. I just don't get it. But, like, giraffes have been following me, and then I've been working on, like, on-camera projects, and they'll be like, this character loves giraffes. I'm like, this is so weird, okay. So I don't know why she's obsessed with them, but I feel like inadvertently she has kind of brought them into my life.
And my third question is, can you do a
Plu
and Gemini voice?
A Plu and a Gemini voice? Probably not, because I didn't get cast, so it was probably a horrible thing. I think Monica's the voice of Plu. No, I'm not gonna do that. Monica's gonna like come down and school me, which would be really cool. But yeah.
I have one last question.
Yes.
So is it fun working with Todd Haverkor and Monica Real?
Yes, they are two of my favorite people. I love when we go to conventions together. Monica and I always bond, and Todd always harasses me. Todd has been one of my closest friends in voice acting, and I'm really tempted to call him right now. This is payback. If he answers, oh, it's Valentine's Day. He just got married.
So,
I just got engaged. Sorry.
Do it.
Oh, get T on blast too. Get the boy to happy on blast too. Yeah, get T on Valor on blast too.
I feel so guilty, but he's done this to me earlier. I would put him on speaker, but let me see if I can.
Oh yeah, get T on blast too.
Gosh, this is an invitation for he's gonna be like, oh, that's fine, but it's on. Miss Lee. That's not it. See, I know Bryce is at a convention. He wouldn't care.
On the phone too, if you have her number.
I don't think I do have Tia's number. I think she just got a new number. I don't have Tia. Okay. Any other questions?
Try calling Colleen.
I don't have Colleen's number.
Monica. Tia. Chris Abbott.
John. Aaron Baker.
Caleb Glass.
Or he may know way.
I just feel so bad calling people that like have children or are married on Valentine's Day.
Tatum's in Milwaukee.
Yes. I know Tatum's in Milwaukee and Bryce is in Milwaukee. But they might be on Valentine's Day. That's the last thing I want to send right back. Do you have a question?
I love your work.
Thank you.
What got you interested in voice acting?
I wanted to be an actor because I wanted to be on Barney when I was 5. So that was like my ultimate goal. That never occurred, which is totally fine. But I started doing voiceover because I sounded like a 3-year-old when I was 7, but I could read like a 10-year-old. So I just started getting cast in voiceover commercials that anytime they needed a child to read off large paragraphs, I just got hired. So I did that my entire life, and then when I graduated from high school, I had worked at Radio Disney and been a DJ and all those things and still worked for Radio Disney. And they said, do you want to come audition for this place called Funimation? They like make cartoons. And I was like, okay. So I went and auditioned for Peach Girl and I got cast as Psy, and then they just kept saying like, oh, here's this other show. Here's this other show. And I remember thinking like, this is amazing. It looks so much like that anime stuff, which I thought was Sailor Moon, Dragon Ball Z, and Pokemon. So I was like, there's like more. That's so weird. And then I think on my, like, as we were finishing up Peach Girl, I said, you know, Zach, it would be really cool if, like, there were a lot more shows like this so we could just, like, do this all the time. And he just, like, laughed, and I was like, I know, it's silly, isn't it? And he goes, oh, shit. And so it began. It's like the saga. I see an arm with, like, a white wristband. Yes.
Hi.
All I saw was your hand, and I was like, there's not even, like, a person attached to it. This is so weird. Fascinating. Oh, like
who would you like yeah, as a character, like guy, male lead or male character that you can interact with?
Wait, so like me as a human shipping with a cartoon here?
Yes.
That's like so weird. Can I like have a cartoon version of my husband? Is that possible?
Because they reveal she's like this huge idol chaser in season 5.
Yeah, I love it. And I read her Sailor V manga stuff, and I was like, man, why do they do like just a Sailor V anime? It would be hilarious, like the prequel. So that would be Sailor V. I think Lucy is somebody that has like a heart of gold. She has so much integrity. She's really passionate about everything, and she might make some silly choices and might not make the best decisions all the time, but she does it from, it always comes from the right place. And then the other one, you said Alicia from Full Metal? She's just, like, adorable. And she will break your heart when bad things happen to people that she loves. And that's all I'm going to say, because I don't want to spoil it for anybody.
Oh, one more thing.
Yes.
I saw Hughes outside looking for you the other earlier today. He seemed very upset that
she wasn't here? What?
I saw Hughes outside earlier looking for you. I don't think he's very happy that his little daughter's growing up and signing autographs.
Probably not. That was the first time that I met Sunny Strait, was right after we recorded the infamous scene. And so I heard his voice, and I had never met him before, and I just went, this is the worst time that you could have, hi. I started to well up, and he goes, oh man, you did the scene today, didn't you? He's like, he goes, I'm Sunny, Daddy loves you, come here. So sad, so awkward. Yes.
Hi. I love all your work. I'm a fan of the characters you play.
Thank you.
I had two questions regarding two specific characters.
Okay.
What were your thoughts of them? First off, what were your thoughts of Mika from Psychopaths? Because like in season one, she was just like a side character.
Like
in season two, she has a big role. And it's
yeah.
Like honestly, that whole season was just kind of weird.
It's really dark.
Yeah, it's really dark. But it's just like the second season just got. Compared to the first season, the second season just got weird and stuff.
It's creepy.
And, yeah.
It's a Urabuchi.
I mean,
Urabuchi wasn't working on season two.
Oh, yeah, he wasn't
we
on season
just
two. There's
did,
your answer.
Yeah, and that's why.
The simulcast for that. So we were trying to record, like, super, super fast. I think they were trying to get, like, I don't know if they're going to do it for the special features, but they sure joked about it. We would preview it in Japanese and watch it, and they're like, so this is what's happening in the scene.
Yeah.
And they, normally the mic is not on. For this show, they left the mic on because they wanted to get our reactions because there's a lot that happens.
Mm-hmm.
And so they'd be like, so this is what you just observed? And I'm like, where did all the blood come from?
Like, I need 10 minutes.
Yeah, I think there were moments where I'd go, oh my, this is not real, right? This is like a dream sequence, and then something else would happen, and I'm like, I don't like this moment. Can we, like, take a moment before I have to record this? They're like, no, it's fresh, go. I'm like, this is like a form of torture. This is really a dark show. Like, we just, like, sit here and watch this happen and be okay with it. Yeah, that was like a show that, like, does a number on you, I think.
And then my other question was, like, aside from her and a few others, a lot of your characters, like, just, like, cute, upbeat, kind of happy characters.
Yeah.
What's your thought of Iris Hart from Hyperdimension?
That was another character that I had a really hard time recording in the beginning, and it's always very awkward recording her.
Yeah.
Because you're, like, in an isolated room, and people are staring at you, and you're saying really uncomfortable things.
It was just kind of weird, because, like, I'm playing the game, I see Plutty, it's like, oh, that's Jeremy's voice. It's like,
uh-huh.
And then transforms, like, oh.
And that is, too.
Yeah.
It was really weird. And I don't know, somebody was like, do you, like, think about the things that you had to say on that show? I'm like, no, some of them I just looked at and went, okay, let's just say this. And, like, get it done. So if you think about it, then things get really weird and awkward. Yes. Yes.
When you were dubbing the Fairy Tale movie, how well prepared were you for the final scene, the really, really sad scene at the end of the movie?
If by prepared, you mean, like, when I found out we were doing it, the director was like, is it going to be easier for you if you see the whole thing first, or do you want to watch it as we go and have the emotion be really fresh? And we recorded the whole thing straight through in, like, 2 days, so I really kind of did watch the whole thing while I was recording it. So we would preview it, I would be hysterical, and then they'd be like, oh, you ready to record? I'm like, yeah. Yeah. Let's not waste the tears. Let's just go for it. I mean, it was some people are like, no, I don't really like to cry in the booth. I just like want to make sure the sound's clean. And that was for a couple of shows, that and for Steins Gate. And I think there's been like Ghost Hunt was one, and I think two other things where I couldn't help it. I mean, I know that the director has said a couple of times, he's like, we're going to have to do it again. I couldn't understand the words because you were too hysterical. But I'm like, I'm sorry, I can't help it. The scene is really emotional. It's really moving me to tears. We're not going to get it any other way. She's crying, why can't I? So I was really, really a mess. And then immediately after, I'm like, man, it was a good scene. It really, really got a lot of emotion out of me. I'm really tired now. So I just cried forever. It was awesome. Yes?
I have two questions. One, I mean, your portfolio is massive at this point.
Well, thank you.
I noticed, from what I've seen, you have a lot of characters who have a very noble, have a very strong sense of, you know, like, right and wrong, things like that. Have you ever just played, like, the manliest bad character, just evil, and
Peach Girl. Yeah, the first character that I ever played in anime, Saiyan Peach Girl, she is just not very nice. She's a mean girl. Like, mean girl. I mean, some of the things that she does, I would sit there and go, like, that can't even happen. We would, like, look it up. I mean, whatever. It's been out for a while. The whole pregnancy thing, I was like, you can't do that. And the guy was like, no, actually, and he like looked it up. I'm like, that is a medical, like, people do that? It's like a real thing? So that was weird. And I mean, I was picked on in high school, and I had just graduated from high school, so it was like a weird, almost cathartic thing to be like, okay, so now I'm on the opposite end of things. And I always say, like, no matter what character I play, I have to love them and know that everything they're doing is for the betterment of something. Like, I don't believe any person or any character does something because they're like, I'm a bad person. I just want to make things difficult for people. I mean, I feel like every person that you talk to, you could say, like, by the general consensus of society, what they did was wrong. But if you talk to them, they're like, well, no, because if this happened in my life and I was protecting this person, or I felt like what they did was wrong, so I was writing the wrong situation. So I had to, like, warp my brain around, and I'm like, no, you cannot steal that many people's boyfriends and think that's okay. Like, again and again, it's not okay. But then it was like, I'm like, well, you know, it is kind of unfortunate for her that, like, why doesn't any guy like her? Like, I would be really hurt by that. And I'm like, well, that's because you're mean. But, so that was an interesting one. So she was not very nice. And then there was another character that I played in Heroic Age, and I guess she was not technically a nice person. She was kind of a bad guy. Yeah, she just wanted to, like, if people weren't really on her side, she just kind of wanted to eliminate them. So, Rogue wasn't all that nice. Nisox wasn't nice in the perception of where the perspective of the show. But, I mean, they just didn't like the Anarchy Sisters. People are allowed to not like other people. That's not like a life and death horrible thing. So yeah, I feel like that, like, bad characters and good characters are all about a perspective. And so I don't think I ever look at any character and I'm like, the character that you're playing the show is mean. She's like a bad seed. I would just go like, well, in the context of the show, she's very misunderstood. Like, Shiki was a prime example of a character that I played that for the first half of the show you thought was like an ultimate villain. And then the second half of the show, the creator kind of flipped the series on its head and really let the audience decide, well, what do you think, who do you think is right and who do you think is wrong, which I thought was a really awesome way to deliver a show because it doesn't tell an audience what to think. It gives you both sides and lets you make your own opinion. Which means a Shiki panel I've been in, people are like, no, and they like are fighting each other. I'm like, it's an anime between vampires and humans. Like, let's just calm it down. zombie thing, people would be like, zombies are better. It's like, okay, well, we don't really have to worry about it right now. There's no zombies and there's no vampires in this room, so nobody's going to be offended. Just settle.
Did people actually fight about which side was right during the panel?
True that. Do what?
Did people actually fight about which side was right during the panel? Like,
oh, yeah.
Audience members breaking up the argument?
Yeah, it got really awkward. There was like a shouting match across, and I was like, okay, we all love each other. This is a happy room. Rainbows and butterflies. Yes. Yeah.
When he auditioned for Not Cool, what did Shay Dawson think of your voice acting profile? Did he end up ever watching any fan base he's been in?
When I first auditioned for Not Cool, I sent in a tape, and then I went and did an audition, and I met with Shane, and he called my agent while I was actually in anime convention. They're like, they really are looking at you for this character. Could you go to Pittsburgh? And I was like, yeah, okay, that would be fine. I didn't find out I was going to Pittsburgh until Thursday, and I was supposed to be in Pittsburgh on Tuesday to start like shooting. So this was like late January, so I found out I'm like, I'm not gonna be with my fiance at the time for Valentine's Day. We were getting married in April, so I was gonna be gone for a month. So it was like very last minute. I had to pack for a month. I'm just like taking every sweater I own, throw it in a basket. And then when I got there, I didn't really, I knew Shane and I had the same birthday, but we hadn't really discussed it because we'd only met in an audition situation. And it would be awkward to be like, hey, we have the same middle name and you have the same birthday as me. I found that out from the internet. because I just feel like that's really how you open the door for like a conversation of Shane being like, are you stalking me? And so I walked in and he goes, I hope this is totally not uncomfortable, but I have researched you on the internet. And I was like, you stalked me? And he was like, I researched you? And I was like, oh, okay, well, I researched you on the internet as well. And he was like, we have the same birthday. I was like, oh, I know. And I was like, I think it's really interesting that my middle name is Lee, and your middle name is Lee. And he was like, shut the front door. We are twins. And I was like, I know that too. So then he was like, yeah, I've seen you do a lot of conventions, and I like have watched a lot of your panels. And he was like, so then I was like, oh, okay, well, she kind of gets the world that I'm in a little bit. And so he and Drew Monson, who played Joel in Not Cool, they like sat together and watched like for 4 hours just anime panels. And we're watching autograph signings from voice actors on YouTube, and he was like, it was just a dark rabbit trail. We'd be like, oh, suggested video? Sure. Suggested video? And he was like, 6 hours went by, and he was like, I wanted to call you and be like, who are these people? Can I meet them? Like, and he goes, I called Joey, and he was like, Joey's a fan of Fairy Tail. So I was like, do you know who this guy is? And Joey's like, yes, I know who that guy is. So this like opened up a new like world for them. And he goes, I watched a couple scenes. He didn't tell me what show it was, but he was like, I was like, that does sound like Jeremy. I said, it's the same person, Shane. It is me. So he was like, just don't do any voices like around me because it would make me uncomfortable. But then he'll come up to me and he's like, can you do a voice? I'm like, he's like, just don't do, it's very weird. Like, he'll ask me to do it, and then he goes, don't do it, it makes me uncomfortable. So.
I saw the YouTube video with you two together. Yeah. The little girl voice,
and
they're like, oh my god, he was terrified.
He gets terrified, but then when Drew does these, like, really weird voices and really weird sound effects, both of us will get very uncomfortable.
Yeah.
Like, because Drew will say things, like, as a very small, like, 4-year-old child, he'll say the most inappropriate things, like, only Drew can. And he goes, okay, Jeremy, your turn. I'm like, I'm not saying that. I will not say that in my voice. I will not say that in any, no. No, it doesn't even make any sense.
One more thing,
yeah.
I'm watching that, your character kind of reminded me of your character side, Peach Girl, with like the mean girl sort of aspect. Even though your character wasn't mean, but
yeah.
Like, the coldness of it sort of reminded me of Psy. Do you
think
that, or?
No, because I guess I thought my character, I didn't think of her being mean at all. I thought of her being very guarded and very defensive because Shane's character had kind of, like, not intentionally, but, like, really, like, destroyed her high school experience. So I was kind of like, I get why she doesn't like you and is not going to be really nice to you. He also like ran in front of her while she was driving, which is not safe. That's like, that's all on him, man.
Yeah,
it's
his fault.
Yeah. Sure. Yes.
Me?
Yes.
I have a quick yes and no question.
Okay.
It's just a record floating around that I got really excited about.
Okay.
I think this would be awesome. I hear Cartoon Network got the rights to an old animated adaptation of Little Women, and that you're slated to be the lead.
Wait, what?
What?
Where did you read this? Because I want to do it.
It was probably just some rumor. It was all the Funimation regulars, and I'm thinking, wow,
that would
sounds amazing. But
that would be the coolest thing ever. Now I have to ask you.
Okay, now it's
No, now I want. That's yes. That's what
you
I want now.
So
that would give
amazing.
Me another reason to start watching Cartoon Network again, since most of the stuff on that channel is garbage.
I would want that so badly. That would be everything. Yes.
Since it was just announced that Anime Boston is going to be premiering Sword Art Online 2 English premiere,
yes.
Is there anything you can talk about that?
I am back and I'm playing Asuna again. And Bryce is back and he is playing Yugita. And Michelle Ruff is playing the new like female awesomeness girl in Gungyo.
About Kono Yuki, who she like, is there a voice?
I don't know if anybody's told me who is playing that role yet.
Yeah.
I'm telling you, we're the last to know everything. Bryce just sent me a text message. He goes, "So we're back." I was like, "Cool."
Yeah, like what about Yui? Is Stephanie still playing Yui?
Yes, Stephanie's back as Yui.
Yeah.
I have seen a couple episodes. I watched a few episodes of the Mother's Rosario arc, and then I had to stop because I was afraid we might not get to dub it, and I got sucked in, and so now I'm very excited that I can officially go watch it and not be like, I won't get to do it.
I was
going to
ask how you reacted to the ending, but...
I've seen very close to the ending, and there was a lot of tears, and so I was like, this is going to be so fun to do. I've gotten like multiple texts from Bryce that he's like, you are going to love this. I'm so jealous of what you get to do in season 2.
That anime actually like made me cry like twice.
It's so sick.
Yeah, like once in in season 1 where Yui was about to disappear. Yeah, and the second time on the season finale of the season of the second season.
Yeah. Oh, it's brutal. Yes.
What was it like voicing Sword Art Online?
It was awesome. That was like the first anime that I got to work on in LA, and that was the first time I worked with Bryce. So it was first of all, I'd seen the show and I loved the show, so I was very excited about the possibility of working on it. I was also very excited to work with Aniplex for the first time, and then the fact that the show turned into be like such a magnanimous project and everybody was so enthusiastic. I know Bryce and I were at Anime Boston when they premiered it, and it was the craziest convention. It was like the craziest first day of a convention where they kind of like said, oh, we're premiering the show. Oh, it's going to be airing on Toonami. Oh, it's going to be like... it was insane, and everyone seemed to be dressed in Sword Art Online cosplay, and it was really fantastic. And it was a really special show in that the director said, I really want to make this seem as realistic as possible, so we're not going to do super wacky. It's going to be really honest, very real. I want certain scenes to feel just like it's a movie. So that was really, really an exciting thing to get to work on and kind of do that side of things in anime, so. Yes.
What was it like working on Sergeant Prom?
Awesome. Because we kind of got to, we were told by the producers and the creators in Japan that they wanted us to use American pop culture references in the show, and that is like, never happened in an anime that I've worked on before. And so that was when I was like working at Radio Disney all the time. So that's why there's a lot of like Miley Cyrus and Jonas Brothers references, because Joel would be like, what's a good like teenager song? And I was like, well, this is what we're playing on Radio Disney, so we did like a lot of Disney references, and so now the show is like has a whole new sort of meaning, I guess. I don't know. It was a lot of fun though, a lot of craziness.
Yeah. Oh my gosh. I'm trying to see who I have not answered a question from yet. I think I might remember. Oh yes.
Yeah. How did you feel when you were asked to do the voice for Lucy in Fairy Tale?
I was shocked because I didn't even audition for Lucy, when I first auditioned for Fairy Tale, I went in to read and I read for Urza and Happy, took the headphones off and was ready to leave because I didn't think there was any chance I was getting cast as Lucy. And the director was like, please get back in there and read for Lucy. And I had seen a little bit of the show and I knew that she was the main protagonist. So I thought like, well, I don't think that that's like me. And he was like, what part of her do you not think you're like? And he started explaining stuff. I was like, well, no, that does sound like me. And then at the end, I was like, but I mean, she's blonde. And he was like, he goes, like almost every character that you play. And then after that, I started like looking, I was like, you know what? He's right. I play a lot of blondes.
Yeah,
and I mean, Natsumi has like red pink hair.
And then there's
Monica
from Kenichi, the
Mighty Society. Yeah, but there's, I mean, like, Sailor V, Patty, Lizzie.
Asuna.
Asuna's like a strawberry blonde, but still, I mean, like, yeah, so that was the only thing. And so then they messaged me on Facebook and said, get to know the Lucy Wikipedia page.
Okay.
And I thought that was also a cruel joke. And then the woman who books the sessions, she called, she's like, so I need to get you for 24 hours for the first 6 episodes. I was like, what character is it? She's like, Tyler told me he told you you're playing Lucy. And I said, this is an elaborate joke because I told Tyler to cut it out because this is getting mean. And so she was like, fine. So I walked in and Tyler's like, we're going to record Lucy. And I was like, you know what? This has really gone too far. We're not doing this anymore. This is really hurtful to my feelings. And so I said, like, who's playing Natsu? He goes, well, it's going to be Todd, but we're going to string him along. I'm going to tell him I haven't cast anybody yet. And so they, like, let me get through the first, like, 3 episodes, and then Todd was like, so have you heard who's playing Natsu? And I was like, no. And he was like, oh. And I couldn't look at him, and he goes, you know something. I go, no, I don't know anything. I know what I've heard, but I don't know what that means. And he was like, share me. I was like, he's stringing you along, you're Natsu. I was like, just act surprised when he tells you. And so when he walked in, he goes, so Sherry told me everything. So and Tyler goes, no more secrets for you. I was like, I'm sorry.
Well, anyway, so far with what I've seen in Fairy Tale, your character is absolutely hilarious.
I think she's pretty funny. I get some really good writing on that show. Like, I know Monica writes and Tyler writes, and I think Josh Greeley writes for that show, among a couple other ones. And they're like comedic geniuses.
So what was your opinion when you heard Bryce was going to be voicing Aaron Yeager for Attack on Titan?
I was super stoked. I was really, really excited. I mean, I love the cast for Attack on Titan. There were a couple people that I was like, knowing that this is like a Funimation project, I know a lot of people were shocked by some of the cast, and I love that. I know there were a lot of actors that were shocked that they were in the cast because it's a Funimation sort of show, and I was like, this is really cool. I'm excited to see them in Funimation Studios, so that was awesome.
Did you get to see like episode 7 and onward of the show?
Of Attack on Titan?
Yeah.
I have not seen that far.
Oh, once you do, I mean,
it's gonna get serious.
It's gonna like blow your brain.
Yeah, a lot of people were telling me that there's a lot of death, and I was like, it's called Attack on Titan. I don't think it's gonna be like, let's go have a picnic in the forest. Like, it's gonna be dark. Do what?
Yeah, like I would have loved to have heard you on the show.
Yeah, I mean that would have been really fun. I don't know.
Yeah, like, I thought you were actually gonna play like Sasha or something.
I know there was a lot of people that were like, I think you'll play this character. I was like, I don't know what's happening.
I don't know. Given how funny Sasha is and how you play a lot of funny characters, hypothetically speaking, if you voiced Sansa, I bet you would be, like, perfect.
Well, thank you. But, I mean, Ashley Birch is a rock star. She's one of my really good friends. She's cracks me up, so I think she's a really awesome choice. Yes? Yeah. No worries.
What was it like when voicing in the Endless Arc of Fairy Tale, doing both Lucys, and especially that one scene where you had to do three different Lucys?
That was awesome. Whenever there's multiple Lucys, because I've done Edelus Lucy, and then Gemini, and then Baby Lucy, and Lucy's mom. And so when they're all in one episode, it's like, well, this is a whole lot of share me happening. So we will record regular Lucy, and then we will record Edelus Lucy, and then we will record Gemini, and then Baby Lucy and Layla's usually last. But we go straight through the whole episode each time, because I tried to do Edelus Lucy and regular Lucy in that arc, and they talk on top of each other, so I would just be like, ah, I'm hearing myself, and I'm trying to talk over myself. Self, stop talking. So we would usually, like, mute me.
Oh, by the way, are you kind of jealous of the fact that Cal Capricorn was able to get achieve the dream that you wanted?
Oh, being on Barney?
Yeah.
No, it's okay. You know? No, I had somebody, I was working on the project I was working on with Kent, and the director of that was the director of Barney, and he came up to me and he was like, and everybody kept telling me, they're like, we can get you on Barney tomorrow. And I remember at 8 years old, I was like, my life will be made. This will be all I've ever wanted. And the director came up and he was like, I'm not going to put you on Barney. And I was like, why? And he was like, I don't feel like that's the way your career needs to go. I think you need to do other things. And I remember thinking at 8, he was like, dude, you don't understand. Barney is my career. But I don't know, if like that had been the case, I don't know if I would have done anything else. And I kind of like that I've done a bunch of different other things other than just like one Barney thing. I know, Tom wore stilts, and that wasn't he like Mr. Knickerbocker?
Yeah.
I like sing that song to him all the time. He's always like, enough. Yes.
Sometimes there are big gaps between like seasons of shows, like Strike Witches season 2 took forever to come out after season 1 did. Was it like difficult, you know, getting back as a character?
No. I mean, it was weird. I mean, it's always weird when they say, so we're going back, we're doing the movie, and it's been like 2 years. But normally when I hear a reference and we do like halfway through, I like slide back into the reference because I played the character for like 24 episodes, so I'm used to everything. Okay. So one more, or that was the last one? Okay.
I'm sorry, guys. We have to go and clear the room.
Thank you for hanging out. I'm going to do the guest uncensored panel.
Oh,
I never do uncensored panels, but this weekend I'm going to do it. So I guess the